Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Guild Gates and Goblins, which is a good thing to be able to say. And more importantly, welcome to the first episode of our new Icewind Dale campaign, which we're all very excited to get underway. Now, of course, we have been away for a little while. There was a bunch of things that led up to that, and it ended up in us taking an extended break. The most important thing to focus on now is the fact that we're back, of course, and we're very excited to do so. We are going to go over a few of the sort of intro things that you might be familiar with, but if you're a new viewer, you might find interesting. So the obvious one is, if you want to listen to an audio version of the show, we're available on just about every single podcast provider, I think, that you could possibly want. With the addition of this time, we're actually on Spotify as well, which is super cool. I just went through the approvals process for that, and we're on Google Podcasts as well. So if you were waiting for us there, we're now on there, which is awesome. We also have a subreddit where you can discuss the show, or more accurately, post memes about Reg. That's the main use of the subreddit if you've watched the Ravnica campaign. You can find that at /r/guildgates, one word. There'll be a link to it down below in the description if you do want to meet people and talk about the show. We're all on there as well, so if you have questions for us, that's a great way to do so. The only other thing before we get into it, really, to point out is this is YouTube. Of course, anything you do to support the video is massively appreciated. That includes liking, commenting, sharing, all that sort of stuff. It only takes a second, but it really helps us out as a show and a channel to grow and get the show in front of as many people as possible. And one other thing, I think I've said that about three times now, but one other thing is please refrain from spoilers in the comment section. Now, we are playing Icewind Dale, Rime of the Frostmaiden. This is an official campaign that's been put out by Wizards of the Coast. There will be changes to it, of course, as we like to do. You saw us doing with Strahd. There will be differences. We have changed things around, but the core of the adventure will remain the same, and therefore we ask you to refrain from spoilers or even hints of what's upcoming, because both the players and other people watching don't know the campaign themselves. So, yes, anyway, that was a lot of talking, and there's a lot more left to go, but my name's Merchant, of course. Welcome to the show, and we're going to quickly go around and let everybody do a little bit of an introduction for themselves. Craig, the most familiar face here, perhaps. we'll start with you.
I suppose, yeah. I've been in all the D&D stuff, so if you've watched it before, you probably know who I am. But in case you don't, I'm just essentially just a friend of Connor's. I've been on his magic videos as well and that sort of thing. But
videos now at this point as well.
Yeah, it's been a good while actually. Yeah, but you can find me on Twitter. At GNGCraig, but that's the only thing I have to plug. Right. I don't know what else to say.
Alias.
Hi, I'm Alias. Also, a relatively longish friend. Not as long as Craig, though, so definitely not as cool.
That's been a long while.
Yeah, I stream magic and a whole bunch of other stuff on twitch.tv/aliasv if you want to come and hang out there. I'm also on Twitter. I'm very Googleable, so if you just Google me, you can find me if you really, really want to.
That's a worrying challenge to issue to people. All right, Justin.
Oh, I'm Ferric Six, new-ish friend to these people. new, I guess I've been around a little bit at this point.
Concerning amount, yeah.
You can find me on YouTube. That's where I primarily make contact. Contact? Words are hard.
It's a good start.
Yeah. My name, not nearly as Googleable. THY. IRIXSYX.
You can't even spell your own damn name. It's above you, so just look above us. There's our names.
Smash the keyboard.
Still there. I'm on YouTube. I'm also on Twitter. Same stuff. Follow me.
Brilliant. Lavinius, that's a hard act to follow.
Yeah, oh boy. Hello, also friend, Kat or Lady Lavinius. I'm frequently on Twitch as a Magic the Gathering arena streamer, just like Alias, and can find me on Twitter as well, Lady Lavinius.
All right, and last and certainly least, John.
Ouch! Ouch! Yeah, let's see. Let's go down the list here. No YouTube, no Twitch, but I am on Twitter under Virgin Mary Gamer, so follow that. Yeah, I'm excited to play with not Connor and everyone else.
Hey, there we go. But yeah, of course, so everybody's been on the channel before, actually, from small amounts of time with Kat, of course, and Theros to John, who just won't go away. But yes, we're very excited to get back into it. And like we said, we are playing Icewind Dale, so I think all of the introductions, all of the spiel, all of the selling out is done. And with that in mind, I think it's time to start our campaign. So, well, why are we heading to Icewind Dale? We're heading to Icewind Dale because Icewind has become trapped in a perpetual winter. Ferocious blizzards make the mountain pass through the spine of the world exceedingly treacherous, and this land has not felt the warmth of the sun in over 2 years. In fact, the sun no longer appears over the mountains, not even in what should be the height of summer. In this frozen tundra, darkness and bitter cold reign as king and queen. Most Dale residents blame Auril, the Frost Maiden, the god of winter's wrath. The shimmering aurora that weaves across the sky each night is said to be her doing a potent spell that keeps the sun at bay. The Dale folk live in a scattering of settlements known as Ten Towns, the drop-off in caravans coming from the south and travel between settlements in this never-ending winter has left everybody feeling isolated. Although each town has resolved to appease the Frost Maiden with sacrifices of one kind or another, even human, no respite from winter's fury seems forthcoming. For adventurers such as yourselves, Ten Towns is a place to test one's mettle, and, in the spirit of heroes who have come before, leave one's mark on this frigid, blighted land. In fact, it's in one of these Ten Towns that our party find themselves, all drawn there by very different reasons, but together nonetheless. It's in Bryn Shander, the largest, most prosperous, and relatively safest of the Ten Towns that our saga begins. In fact, it's just another grim day in Bryn Shander. Howling wind, bitter cold, and foul tempers. But today the town is abuzz with news about a series of recent killings. Before the murders, the only question on everyone's mind was, will summer ever return to Icewind Dale? Now, the question is, will I be the killer's next victim? Nothing breeds fear and paranoia like a murderer with no name. 3 cold-blooded murders have been committed in the past month around Ten Towns, the most recent of which was in Bryn Shander itself. A dwarven glassblower found dead in his own home. Each victim has been found with a dagger of pure ice through the heart. What's the connection between the victims? The crowd around you in the market whisper and murder their own ill-thought-out theories, as the town crier calls out the day's news, conspicuously omitting mention of the recent murder. As for our fated party of adventurers, each one of your attentions snaps back to the barrel-chested man, crying out on stage in the middle of the market.
And the last announcement, don't forget the new moon raffle is to take place 3 nights from now. All right, today's announcements were brought to you by Black Iron Blades. Need a blade? Black Iron's the place. Also, we have a special guest who has kindly made a small donation to announce something to you all. Good day, and stay safe.
The crowd begins to sidle away as an elderly dwarven woman, still standing proud in well-crafted armor, takes to the small, rickety stage. She seems disheartened by the crowd's apparent apathy, but her voice rings out true nonetheless.
Ah, hello, dearies. My name's Hlyn Trollbane. And to keep things short, I have work available for any here today brave enough to take it on. You must be stout of heart and strong in nature, for I will ask a lot, but I have gold to pay. And you have my oath as a shield dwarf, that your work is for the good of all here in the Dale. If you are interested, please come and speak to me post-haste. I shall be remaining in the market for the upcoming hour.
And at this point, a large Goliath appears to call out.
Excuse me, Miss Dwarf. I'm happy to sign up for you.
Oh, excellent, my Goliath friend. And what about your companions here?
Now, initially confused by her strange question, the rest of you realize that the crowd has dissipated entirely, leaving only the Goliath who called out, as well as a few other unusual sorts. So Fletch, the Goliath, why don't you give us an image of yourself?
All right, okay, 2 seconds. So Fletch stands just over 7.5 feet tall, his head is bald, and he has ashen grey skin, but a relatively lean build for a Goliath. He wears a chainmail vest overlaid with boiled leather, and you can see there's numerous tokens and animal trophies hanging from that. A battered longsword and longbow are strapped across his back, as well as a quiver stuffed full of arrows. The exposed skin of his arms and face are marked with swirling patterns.
All right, and Fletch, as you're looking around, you see an unusual-looking man dressed in somewhat shabby clothing. Eddie, why don't you describe yourself?
Shabby? Come on now. yeah, so Eddie is a water genasi. I googled it because I didn't know how to say it. It's genasi. His normal size and stature is not what you'd first notice, but you would notice his dark seafoam green skin. He's wearing long black pants, a dirtied sun-bleached white linen shirt, and a large brown winter coat with matching boots. He sports a trapper hat with some type of fuzzy animal fur on the front and sides. Coming out the back of his hat is a ponytail of salt and peppered hair, about mid-back length, and it seems to look constantly wet. On his face, he's large, unkempt beard, graying and white at the tips. That actually sticks out of his face probably as much as it sticks down from his face. So that's Eddie.
All right, Eddie, as you're glancing around, looking at this Goliath who's been talking out, another figure catches your eye, who, quite opposed to yourself, is dressed in somewhat resplendent-seeming armor. Darmok, why don't you introduce yourself?
Darmok is a very large dragonborn wearing a full white armor. There is chainmail as well as a clip around to have a long white cape. His scales are also in a whitish hint, very, very like snow. And he's very large, blue eyes, no hair to speak of. But he's seems to be very almost glowing with the surrounding winter surroundings.
All right, Darmok, glancing around, you notice that one of the last remaining people is a somewhat stout-looking dwarf, Dorothea. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Dorothea Brightsteel is a dwarf with pale skin and gray, sullen eyes. She looks very much like death warmed up. You can see she hasn't had a decent night's sleep in a while. Her skin is pale and her hair is a burnt umber, so very rich, dark red. And, while her appearance is somewhat disheveled, you can see that her attire is neatly pressed and taken care of. She's got a big fur coat on that probably was someone's fluffy, who knows. You know, she's not exactly the biggest individual, so don't need the biggest coat. And her attire is also adorned with a golden horned unicorn, which is a symbol of her goddess. You can see her hands are very rough and calloused, and you don't really see, but she does have quite a lean, muscular build underneath all of these layers. And she is a blacksmith, and the burns on her hands tend to indicate this. So, yeah.
All right, as you get a look at each other, only one figure remains. Izar, why don't you give us a description?
Izar Sol is dressed in only the finest of clothing. It appears that there may be more form than function here, although Izar does not look to be too cold. Of course, he's bought the finest wools that money could buy. He's wearing nice blacks with accents of golds and reds. His hair is this sleek black that flows down to what appears to be his shoulders. He has medium-length horns, curling just back a little bit. His skin is a quite crimson red, with his eyes having black sclera and an iris that is quite a bright red that's mixed with flakes of yellow, orange, and gold that appear to flicker and shimmer in the light, kind of like a dancing fire. He is relatively reasonable height at about 190 centimeters. He wears a necklace with a rather long and very perfect piece of red tourmaline down his chest. And he stands, of course, with a stature befitting of royalty, which does not exactly make much sense in this jury.
Anything
else?
I think that was the best eye description we've ever had.
Yeah, Disney. That was amazing.
Well done, Justin.
Look who did their homework.
Yes.
Well, as you all take each other in and you get a sort of cursory impression of perhaps your companions for the time being, the dwarf on the stage appears to still be looking expectantly towards you, Fletch, with a cocked eyebrow. He goes, well?
Well, I guess the first question for me is, how much is this pain?
Oh, 100 gold. I think you'll find that more than satisfactory.
And I'll say to the locals, the newer people might not know this, but to the locals of Icewind Dale, you would be aware that 100 gold is actually quite a tidy sum in the Dale. That's a good amount of money.
100 gold.
Is
that's more than I make fishing.
That's Is that the lot?
Yes. Well, split between you, it'd be 20 gold apiece. You know, that's more than enough, I think.
And what exactly was the job again?
Well, it requires a little bit of discretion. I'm sure, and at this point she walks down the staircase to the side of the stage and comes over and stands in a huddle with you all and goes, well, I'm sure you're all aware of the killings that have been happening. I've somewhat taken it upon myself to bring an end to these things, for I have information that, you know, the speakers here aren't really interested in, and, well, on accounts of, I guess, feeling pressed to do so, I would like to take matters into my old hands, but my old hands is correct, for I've, well, in case you can't tell, I've seen my fair share of life, and I don't really feel up to it myself. I guess without beating around the bush, I have a suspect in mind, and I think somebody needs to put a stop to them.
Well, that really sounds pretty straightforward to me.
I mean, sure.
Do you really need five of us?
Well, you know about the ice daggers and other strange signs on my suspect. I think that caution may wish to be wagered, which is why I'm finding a group.
Instead of the city guard, for example?
Oh, I went to the guard. Or more accurately, I went to the speakers, who were in charge of the guard, but they didn't want to know anything about it. I'm afraid they're somewhat predisposed to other matters right now.
Well, I mean, I don't know about the rest of you, but I could sure use the money, so I'm in.
I don't need the money, but living a lifestyle as fine as mine can never hurt.
Sure you don't want to get any of your clothes dirty there, sir?
I know a few tricks to clean them quite nicely.
Sure that's you do.
Digitation.
And this, the dwarf, Clint, puts her hands up and she just looks towards you and goes, oh, and I don't want you getting the wrong idea. I'm pretty sure of this man's guilt. I've seen him the other scene myself, but no one was interested.
Well, I have a few questions about the crime itself, if you don't mind answering them.
Oh, of course.
So you said it was the glassblower who was killed. What was his name?
Oh, well, I don't know his name. I wasn't familiar with him. And the guard aren't exactly pressed to release such details.
See. And, well, how do you know the person who did this?
Well,
how do you know to recognize him?
To recognize him. It's quite simple. This is perhaps part of why I'm hiring a group. There are certain unusual things about this individual. I've seen him once or twice myself. Now, his eyes glow with the brightest blue, like fire turned into ice. And I don't just mean he's got a twinkle. I mean they glow. It's most unnatural. Also, well, I don't know how long you've all been in the Dale. And she takes a long toke on this long wooden carved pipe she produces from her pocket and goes, but safe to say it's quite nippy. Now, I've never seen this individual wear so much as a doublet. He's always faffing about in a shirt. Highly irregular. I don't think you'd have too much trouble seeing him.
Whereabouts?
Also, I know his name.
Oh, what's his name and where can we find him?
His name is Sephek. It's S-E-P-H-E-K.
I got the I. I said an I. God damn it.
Sephek Kaltro is his name. I've heard whispers of him, but haven't got far with my inquiries.
So you don't really know what he does around the town. You've just seen him.
No, but these murders have been happening in a few towns. So there must be something taking him between the locales.
Right, well, let's go say hi.
Where can we find him?
I don't know that.
Oh.
If I knew that, I might give a crack at it myself. It's mostly the wandering about in the cold that I can't be bothered with.
Hey. Well, 20 gold is it's well worth the time, I guess.
Well, something after last night's gambling adventure. I guess it'll do for now. Let's try to find this person.
Well, I guess let's go look at the local establishments. See if any of the...
I have someone we can get in touch with, don't worry.
Alright.
That's not eerie or anything.
And with that, Flynn kind of raises her hands and goes, well, I wouldn't want to incriminate myself any further, so I'll be off, but I tell you what, if you're successful, I'll meet you back in the market tomorrow. I think we should act with the utmost haste, given the cycle this killer seems to be in. But don't worry, if you're not there, I come to the markets most days around noon, so you'll always be able to find me here.
And how will you know we've completed our task?
Well, listen, I've been familiar with such work myself in the past, and just doing something definitive.
Perhaps one of his eyes.
Aye, an eye would work fine.
Aye,
aye. Had to do it.
You know what they say about an eye for an eye.
Hey, exactly. Sense of humor like that'll keep you alive in the deal.
All right, well, let's go find our Sephic Keltroll.
At this point, I assume we haven't technically met, if kind of described ourselves. So I'm going to say, by the way, my name is Izar. Izar Sol. The pleasure is all yours.
Is it now?
Oh, I really don't like this one.
I'm a bright, shining sun that this place desperately needs.
Did you see her?
Oh, great! Let's sacrifice him next! I think that's a great idea. It's gonna bring winter, make
well,
it go away.
Actually, so Izar and Darmok, make me a history check, both of you.
Ooh.
First roll of the campaign. So 15 and 13. Okay, 13. I would say that you'd both be aware by now of the local tradition and what the town crier was referring to, where every new moon a raffle is taken of all inhabitants of the town, and the winner of said raffle is sacrificed to Aurel the Frost Maiden by being left outside in the cold in a desperate attempt to appease and bring back summer.
That sounds awful.
And that is what Dorothea is referring to.
You're such a bright, shining sun. Let's just go let you out in the cold.
Yes,
there.
I second that.
Anyway, Dorothea, call me Thea for short. But don't dare call me short.
Noted.
You can just call me Fletch.
Fetch?
Fletch.
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 Okay. The name's Eddie. That's it. It's just Eddie.
Eddie. The name's Darmok of the Nerexis clan.
Who?
Might. The Dragonborn Nerexis clan?
Never heard of them.
Would we have heard of this, Connor?
No.
Okay.
Not with your background.
Right, let's go. I'm going to start marching off into some, I don't know. Where the heck are we going? I don't know.
Is it the church or the house of the Morning Lord?
It's the house of the Morning Lord. It should be illustrated on your maps, I believe.
Is it?
Yeah, we're still on the world map.
Oh, it would help if I put you in Brinchander. There you go. Hello, Brinchander. Welcome to Brinchander.
If we go to the House of the Morning Lord, there's someone we can meet with there.
I'll head off
in that direction.
All of you would be aware by now, so for the audience, the House of the Morning Lord is
the closest thing akin to a church in Bryn Shander to the God of the Sun, and it's little more than a house that's been kind of retrofit to purpose, but it's still a place of great cultural significance, especially given the times that the Delfolk find themselves in. So you make your way to the house, Fletch? You're leaving the others?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, so you guys make your way through Bryn Shander. Honestly, it's not a particularly large town, although it does certainly stand out in 10 towns. There's maybe a little bit over 1,000 souls live here, and as you make your way through the streets, you can see that on this wintry day, people are in reasonably good spirits, despite the dark events of the past few days. It seems like the town is starting to recover a little bit as people return back to their daily routines. So the town is fairly busy, and as you approach the House of the Morning Lord, you notice that in a sort of lackluster but admirable attempt, it's been draped with a few hastily painted banners, and seems like, you know, maybe the doorknobs have been extra polished just to try and spruce up this once decrepit old home that's been repurposed. But nothing really seems too out of the ordinary. Outside the house itself, you can see a man in very simple robes with a rope belt who appears to be tending to the few sort of hardy shrubs and evergreen plants outside. And other than that, the only other character here is what appears to be a homeless woman slumped against a house opposite the House of the Morning Lord, sitting by an alley with her few meager possessions in front of her, occasionally looking up and taking a glance at you, but doesn't seem too interested currently.
All right, I would like to start walking towards the homeless woman.
Okay.
But I'll turn back to the rest of the party and say to them, all right, you lot, stay quiet. Let me do the talking, all right?
All right.
Okay.
I don't exactly appreciate your tone, but I respect the customs of this weird land.
All right, so as you heed Fletcher's words, and Fletch, you start heading and leading the group towards this homeless woman leaning against the wall. She reaches out to you at first and goes, "Arms for the poor, mister. Please, I'm losing my eyesight." And the others, you see, as she even begins to reach the end of this sentence, a wicked grin spreads across her face, and she seems to kind of give you a subtle nod towards the alleyway she's next to, and shuffles up to her feet and begins walking down it.
Yeah, I'll just follow her into the alleyway.
All right, so as you follow this beggar, hunched over and shuffling her way into this darkened alley between two appearing to be disused houses, as you make it a good way down, she suddenly spins on the spot with surprising agility. She turns on her heel to face you all and stands up straight. And with what appears to be a wave of her hand, all the signs of age and the sort of rough life that she'd seemingly been living disappear from her face. And you're left standing face to face with quite an attractive woman, probably in her early 30s with dark hair and very, very athletic, powerful build. And she looks towards you, Fletch, and goes, "Well, hello, Fletch. Must be a few weeks since we've last spoken."
It certainly has, Beldora. How you been?
Oh, you know, sitting in a gutter, begging for pennies, keeping my eyes open.
Oh, fair enough, fair enough. Listen, I've got a bit of a job I've taken on with this lot here. We're looking for someone in Bryn Shander, a fellow by the name of Sefik Caltrow. You heard him?
And with this, an eyebrow raises. And instead of answering your question, she looks back towards the rest of the group and simply goes, "What about them? Are they to be trusted, Fletch?"
"Don't know yet."
"Oh, darling, you can trust me." And he gives him a wink.
Well, that's a disconcerting answer.
"I did tell them to be quiet."
"Very well. I suppose it's no harm, really. Sefik Caltrow, you say? A curious name to come by. What's led you to finding out about him?"
"One of the a dwarf in the market suspects him in the murders that have been going on."
"Hmm. You met a very astute dwarf. I think she may know more than perhaps even she thinks. Yes, Sefik Caltrow is known to us as an organization. We've been following him for, well, must be a few months at this point. He's only recently become active, though. But yes, he's certainly been on our radar. The good news, for all of you, is I believe he is currently in Bryn Shander. I don't think he's moved on yet."
Well, do you know where we can find him? We've got orders to take him out.
To take him out? Oof. I'm afraid I don't know where you can find him. Perhaps try the market. The only thing that I know, thanks to some contacts I have in the city guard, is that he's working as a form of bodyguard for a caravaner named Torga. She's a trader, travels around 10 towns, you know, supply and demand and all that. So perhaps somebody in the market would know more about Torga's plans, or perhaps her workings in Bryn Shanda. But, Fletch, do be careful. Everything we know seems to say that Sefik Kaltro may not be as he appears.
Oh, you know me. I'll be right as rain.
Yes, but I'd rather not clean up poor bodies of your friends.
Fair enough.
Right, I don't know if we have a secret handshake or...
Everyone's just kind of standing there like...
Eldora just seems to kind of be curiously eyeing each of the other members of the group, almost as if giving you a chance to pitch in, as it were.
I won't say anything. I was told not to say anything, so...
Following orders.
All right, I guess I'll turn back and come out of the alley. And
as Beldora does not follow you back out of the alleyway, she seems to disappear into the shadows as you walk away. So what would you like to do? I assume you're going to head to the market and see if you can search out some information.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah. Right.
In this map, is the market in the middle kind of open space?
Yes, the market
space?
Is the open space in the middle.
Gotcha. Yeah,
all right, so you head back to the market, and you can sort of see the sort of hubbub of earlier has died down, almost like the lunchtime rush is over in a way. The stage now lies empty, and Flynn's nowhere to be seen. It seems as though she's left already. But what is open? Seems to be a few stalls, a couple selling sort of dried herbs and spices, and one seems to be a halfling aggressively beating out some sort of pelt rug to lay onto a pile of others that he appears to be selling. But outside of a couple of full stalls in this rug trader, there don't really seem to be too many stalls open right now. It doesn't seem like a busy period.
Where should we start?
Well, maybe if we just ask some of the local traders, they'll know her. Torga.
Yeah, perhaps. Let's start with that lad over there. I'm going to mission towards the dude hitting the rug.
The rug trader, okay.
I hope the rug trader has the best voice ever.
I hope so. Let's find out.
Here we go. Wow, no pressure or anything. Okay. But as you sort of step into the... Of course, this is an outdoor stall, but as you step into the vicinity of the rug trader's stall, this halfling looks up towards you, and you can see now that he's definitely worked a life outside. He has weathered marks all over his face and somewhat of a ruddy complexion that perhaps says too much of a fondness for cider. And he looks up towards you, Dorothea, although not too far up. And he goes,
Oh, all right, my dear. How can I help you? You looking for a rug?
No, we're looking for some information. Perhaps if we help you out with that rug.
It's a premium rug economy.
Yeah, we don't need rugs. We're looking for information. I can help you clean that rug real fast if you give us some information.
And how would you do that?
I have some tricks up my sleeve. I'll prestidigitate some little sparkles out of my hands.
With that, he takes half a step back and he goes, All right. I assume you can do something more impressive, but fair enough. Well, what information are you looking for?
Before I was so rudely interrupted, sir, we're looking for a caravan named Torga. You know her?
Torga. Yep. And with this, he goes back to hitting his rug.
Would you perhaps know where we can find her?
She comes by here every now and again.
Mm-hmm.
Tends to be quite busy, I'd say. Not sure you'd be able to find her easily, going all between the towns. And he's still not turning to face you and focusing on just beating the ever-living something out of this seemingly sheepskin rug.
Just beat the devil out of it.
Do you know when last she was here?
Oh, I reckon sometime in the last 1 to 8 weeks, I reckon.
Super helpful, thank you.
Don't really know much, I'm afraid. But if you're not buying a rug, I think it's best if you chew it off.
Well, it's certainly not like you're very busy, sir.
Aye, well, perhaps you shouldn't go sticking your nose in things that don't concern you. Horger's, and there's he kind of furrows his brow a little bit and goes, all right, look, Horger can be a bit rough-handed is all.
You're
you know,
scared
she
of
runs with some... Not scared, just, you know, I like to have my business with her and leave. She likes to run with a few rough types. I mean, I understand it, you know, dangerous terrain and all that, but she ain't the most pleasant to get along with, and you'd do best to be away. By the looks of you, I don't think you're trading.
Do we look like the type that wouldn't be able to handle?
Well, rightfully so, I don't know what you can handle. I just wouldn't want you getting into trouble is all. This town's got enough of that.
I understand that, but there's coin in it. We need to know where she is.
There's coin for me?
If you were to help us, and you know where she is, and where we can make this
much quicker. I know all sorts of stuff for coin.
There might be some coin in it for you.
We don't work in mites in the market. How much coin you got?
What would you be looking to get?
With this, he kind of raises an eyebrow and casts his beady glance around each one and goes,
why don't you give me 5 gold pieces? That'd be right good and helpful.
I'll prestidigitate a square foot of his carpet clean.
All right, so you prestidigitate the entire pile of sheepskin rugs that he was working on. Half of it just sort of whooshes free of all dirt and is looking absolutely pristine. He goes,
huh, all right. Tell you what, Mr. Wizard Man, do the rest of them, and then we'll talk.
Mm-mm.
All right, finish this pile.
No, you give us the information we seek. Simply clean your face.
I'll cut you a deal. I'll tell you what you want to know, but he's got to stay here and work for the afternoon. And he gestures towards you. He's until everything's clean, I say.
No.
All right, and 5 gold pieces.
You did that in like 2 seconds flat. Just say yes, man.
I'm going to prestidigitate them soiled again.
Oh, it's one of these.
Oh, Justin, I hate to be that guy, but can you do that with prestidigitation? Because yep. I think you can only clean things with it.
Nope. You instantly clean or soil any object.
Wow. Clean or soil.
Wow. Oh,
all right. Justin is the master.
So
with this, you can see
he loves it.
From the floor, all the kind of dust and, you know, bits that you whooshed off of them just almost like ethereally just straight back into the pile. And looks and he goes, all right. Can't say I appreciate that, but I get your point. So that'll be 5 gold pieces.
Yeah, there it is. There it is.
I can put them back to be cleaned without staying here for the afternoon, and you give us the information. It's very simple.
Listen,
it's nice,
my lover,
everyone wins.
I ain't that interested in watching you clean and dirty my rugs again and again.
All right, and I've had enough of this waste of time, and he's going Darwin's gonna take out the longsword.
Thank you.
And just be like,
ooh, no,
we need to find the information.
I like it, Dorothy.
I will
like,
give you 2 coins.
Please don't threaten
Tell
the locals
us now.
Please. Oh shite.
You've never bartered in Baldur's Gate, I see.
At this point, the halfling takes a step back, visibly terrified. And
2
just goes,
coins.
Guards! Guards!
No, put your weapon away, Darmok, for crying in a bucket.
At least 2 people running at you from the edge of the market.
Oh, shite.
Before you can particularly react, there's two guards dressed fairly sort of haphazardly, I would say. They're in somewhat matching uniforms, but this is not Waterdeep. This is not Baldur's Gate. They don't have pristine guard uniforms on, but it's very obvious that these guys are members of the city guard. They wear the crest of Bryn Shander, which is antlers over a sheet of wheat. Wheat? What? Sheaf of wheat, which is how you actually say those words. They have like kind of like roughly hewn cloth armbands with that on. And they both seem to be carrying halberds. They're both humans, and they run up to you and go, "All right, Hazini, is something wrong? He's giving you bother?"
Quick question, Connor. Do I know these two? Would I know them?
Oh, make me a... Make me a... I mean, make me a perception. They've got helmets on, you know, they're kind of in their guard regalia. Make me a perception check.
I like the idea that Connor has this like web of the backstory that we do know and don't know, and we're like,
I'm trying to learn.
John discovers D&D.
I rolled 17.
17. Okay, all right.
And so a 22.
And a 22. We did.
It rolls twice.
Advantage. Yeah. You rolled a 17. Don't spook 17. Me.
Right. Sorry.
So, with a 17, Dorothea, you have a lingering suspicion that the guard who didn't talk might be a guard named Marcus, where you actually patched up some of his equipment for him at a very, very reasonable rate after Black Iron Blades had erroneously repaired it and made it worse.
Black Iron Blades. All right, so I'm going to look at the other guy then and hopefully recognize my handiwork on him. Be like, Marcus, is that you?
With your perception roll, I'd say that you do see a certain signature that you put on everything on the haft of his sword that's hanging by his waist as he wields a halberd. And he looks down towards you and he goes, "Oh, Dale, let's calm it a little bit. These ones are, well, at least she's all right. She patched up. Do you remember, I broke my sword on that kobold's teeth? Yeah, she's the one who fixed it."
Yeah, how's it doing? Doing good, right?
And with this, Marcus, the larger of the two guards, Dale, the larger of the two guards, kind of, he sort of visibly breathes out a little bit and takes half a step back and he goes, "All right, well, that's always appreciated. I know a lot of the lads speak highly of you. However, I've still got to ask, Hazini, are you all right?" And of this, the halfling, his face is still white as a ghost, kind of takes a step forward and goes, I think, you know what, we're fine. I think, negotiations just got a bit out of hand, but, well, this lad was just about to pay me 5 gold pieces for something, and, then we can all move on and be happy with our day. Isn't that right?" And he kind of looks up at you, Darmok.
I'm gonna try and get Darmok, and, like, just gesturing, like, "Put the freaking sword away, please."
Darmok, puts the sword back. "Yes, that's right. We're just
all right.
Having
we're
some
right
issues.
As rain. Thank you, though, lads. Always appreciate the fast response." And with us, the two guards kind of go, "Okay," and kind of shake their heads a little confused and head back to their postings near the entrance to the market.
Not even been 20 minutes.
That'll be 5 gold.
All right, you know what?
I'll tell you what you want to know,
for
and then you can bugger off. If I see you again, it'll be 50 gold.
I'm going to scrabble in my belongings and try and piece together 5 gold. Or at least their worth.
All right. Do you have 5 gold to give him?
I have no idea if I have 5 gold.
I think I do, yes.
I have... I don't know what my starting gold is, but I'm sure I have 5 gold.
Who's giving him? Somebody give him 5 gold.
I have 5 gold to give him, so I'm like that.
Okay, cool.
Darmok was going to...
Okay.
Well, you just subtract 2.5 each.
It's just some gold. We'll get some more back.
Cool,
just...
resources. All right. Yeah. Take 2.5 off both of you. And then he sort of counts out the coins painstakingly. Despite it being 5 coins, he very slowly, staring you in the face, counts it out in front of you.
Slowly.
All right. What do I know about Torga? Well, Torga's in a spot of bother, I would assume, although I would be taking a guess. However, I do know a couple of things for sure. Torg has been buying and selling. Well, not so much recently. Mostly selling, actually. So, rumor has it
She's looking to get off the deal. I think she's heading back down south. Now, I don't know why, but if that's the case, they're in town for a few days resupplying. That's the only reason I can think of them still being here. Normally, they'd be going off day after they've sold. So, now that they're heading down south, that means that all of her crew and everything's still here. So, is there anything else I can help you with?
The obvious being, where is she?
Well, as for Torga, can't say I rightfully know. But any of her workers, and believe me, she rolls with quite a lot of them, they're probably staying up in the inn of the north. That's where most of the, well, I like to call them heavies, like to stay. The Northlook Tavern, I'm sure you're all familiar with it by now.
Oh, aye.
And it pops into your head that the Northlook is, what we'd call the fighty pub in Britain, which is where some of the rougher elements go. Because I reckon they're all up in the Northlook. At least, that creepy fella she's always with. He never leaves her side when they're working, but Torga's a private type. She'll be bolt-holed away, probably has a house here for all I know. But anyone who works for her, I imagine they're up in the Northlook.
Well, the Northlook is a fun place to go hang out. I hope you're all ready to get ale spilt all over you.
Not a worry for me. I give a cheeky smirk to the carpet
yeah,
boy.
Yeah, we can't all make things super pretty like you.
I was just there last night. Let's go.
Well, good. So you know what it's like.
No.
Right, follow me. Let's go.
Oh, as we depart, are there any carpets that are currently clean?
Petty? Are you going to be petty?
Wow. I'm going to be petty.
Don't be a petty. Oh, God.
Make me a quick perception check. See if you can spot the state of his wares.
Such a
17.
Dick.
17. It looks like behind him, there's a pile where he's throwing the cleaned ones.
Oh my God.
As we leave, I'm going to go ahead and just do a little flick of my hand. I guess technically all I need is verbal. Oh no, I need verbal and somatic, yeah. Do a little flick of my hand, and they are now dirty. Carpet boy.
Are you just turning around to leave after that?
Yep.
All right. I would like Justin, you to make me a dexterity saving throw. As you hear
throwing
you,
the carpet at you.
Oh, you little bastard! And you sense something that feels strangely like a large stick that he was hitting the rugs with fly through the air towards you, and you take. I'm just going to roll this out in the open so you can feel the pain. You take 4 points of bludgeoning damage as I accidentally roll as an awakened dinosaur. There you go. You take 4 points of bludgeoning damage as this stick cracks you in the back of the head. He goes, and there's more like that, so I'd bugger off if I was you.
Darmok's going to take the stick. He's going to just break it immediately.
Ooh, maybe a strength check. This is a thick stick.
Thick stick?
16. Ooh, all right, 16. Yeah, you managed to, with some effort, crack through this sort of, like, treated, hardened wood log.
And then Darmok's also going to cast Lay on Hands for the 4 points, just right on his back, and say, mess with my friend again, and the sword's coming out.
Darmok is my boy!
Again, and I'll get my other stick.
Oh, that stick on the ground?
Would you two
no,
please
my other
stop?
Stick, you thicko.
That'll be in multiple breaks.
Oh, you're gonna break my other stick twice,
oh my
are you?
God!
Oh, I'm terrified.
You two are like freaking children. Come on!
Yeah, call your guards again.
Oh,
see what happens.
Crying
do you want
in
me
a
to do
bucket.
That? Because you just vandalized. I'll do it.
Stop it, leave it, come, let's go,
go on,
now.
Yes.
We just.
Holy crap.
I can hear his laughter chase you away.
I do my best to tug them, my little small statured dwarf.
You realize every time.
This is an evil party, you broke his stick, what the hell?
Every Darmok. Time you break the stick, you just give him more sticks.
I love your moxie. You're terrible at negotiating, but you're absolutely fantastic at being as petty as I am.
I don't understand. I'm
Who are you, Lord? What was mind. That? That was awful. Why didn't you ask someone else if he wasn't giving up any information? Why?
I didn't want to waste more time. More crime equals more coins.
If this person's a caravaner, we could have gone to the stables or something like that. Why?
Fletch, I don't
we
know.
Had it, let us go.
Oh, these two. So, Eddie, how are you right. doing?
I have no idea what I just witnessed.
I don't know either.
What
oh, come
the
by the way,
was that?
Why is your hair wet and not frozen?
I haven't. I'm a Genasi. I'm. I don't really remember my childhood, but I've always been like this.
Even though I'm from like a large city, mm-hmm. would I know what the heck that is?
Well, Genasi.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just seen Genasi. You might not have okay. seen a water Genasi, that's somewhat rarer. Yeah, you would have seen probably earth and fire Genasis, primarily. Mostly just out and about in the city, maybe not holding sort of normal roles within the city, but as travelers and adventurers, yeah, you just seen Genasi.
Ah! Interesting.
Wait, Genasi, why can't you remember your childhood?
Now, Fletch, you might never have seen a Genasi.
I
was it traumatic or something?
No, I just never remembered. I
holy
just remember being at the docks a lot. I don't know.
What, that, as a child at the docks?
I guess I spent basically my entire life there.
Right.
So maybe I was young at what? I don't know.
Maybe you were young? Is that what you don't know if you were young?
I just shrug. I don't.
Are we walking while this conversation's happening?
Yes.
Okay.
Well
please,
so.
God.
I'm hustling now. I'm just like, holy, I don't want to know your little sub stories.
Not yet. Not yet, Dorothy. Come on now.
All right. So you guys, as your horrendous conversation continues, you guys begin to approach the North Wall Tavern. Now, it's not too late in the day, remember? You were sort of listening to the news at noon. A few hours have passed since then. You'd guess it's around 3 or 4. So while it's never exactly bright in Icewind Dale right now, the sort of dismal greys and murky greys haven't quite started to fade away to complete darkness yet. So you're still in a relatively early part of the day. So the tavern doesn't look too busy, basically. As you approach it, you can see that the North Wall Tavern is actually remarkably well made. Like most buildings in Bryn Shander, it's been constructed of stone and reinforced timber, etc. And it seems to be remarkably well kept. Its appearance doesn't necessarily match up with the sort of reputation it seems to garner at times. You get the impression that the owners take quite good care of it. But as you approach the tavern, there's nobody outside. You notice that there appears to be a few souls inside milling about, but as you approach the doors themselves, outside seems free of activity at this point. So is there anything you'd like to do, or would you just like to head in?
I would be beelining for the door.
I'm gonna stand behind literally everyone else before they walk through the door.
All right.
Great.
I've heard how this place can be. I don't know. It's spooky. Spooky with 9 health, you know?
Oh, it's fine. Just a little. It's just a little rough around the edges.
All right, so as you guys make your way through the door of the North Wall Tavern, you see there are a few people drinking inside, kind of what you get the impression might be the regulars, some older folk, a halfling, an elf, and two of their human friends seem to be taking up a table and just sipping pints of IPA quietly, and there doesn't really seem to be much hubbub whatsoever. There is a barman standing behind the bar, sort of looks a little bit older, but not too old, maybe sort of late 40s, early 50s. A lot of scars on him. This guy's clearly seen a lot of action before. His hair shaved bald, and this guy looks like he'd be sort of, you know, better off in the city guard than tending bar. But nonetheless, he is there, just leaning on the counter. He seems to be sipping a pint of his own, in fact, and he fixes you with somewhat suspicious eye, especially you, Darmok, as you head in.
I would go straight to the counter. Would I know the bartender's name?
Yes. You would know that this bartender is called Scramsax, and he is a somewhat he is called Scramsax. It's S-C-R-A-M-S-A-X. And hey, you would know that despite his incredibly rough-looking exterior, he's actually quite a nice guy. He actually cuts you a break a lot of the time. He's let you off the hook with gambling more than once, as long as you repay it at a later date, of course. But he's always kind of seemingly, you know, kept an eye out for his patrons and does his best to keep them safe, even amidst the rough environment. He doesn't police people particularly, but if somebody's causing trouble, typically Scramsax will sort them out. He's a pretty tough guy, so yeah, you'd be somewhat familiar with him. He'd know your name, for instance.
Okay. Hey, Scramsax, how is it today?
With this, he puts down his pint and takes a sort of straightens his stance a little bit and smirks a little and goes, oh, Darmok, honestly surprised you're standing today.
I can always get up the next day, regardless of how much I drink.
Well, there's that dragonborn resiliency that I hear so much about.
Yes.
That one would have had me out for a week, I think. Tell me, did you win or lose last night?
Another loss.
Oh, never change, eh?
I'll never know when to quit.
Yeah, all that. What can I do for you today? You brought friends.
I did. Well,
around the poker table with her. Him. It would go terribly wrong.
Let's talk. A round of drinks for my friends. Just as a normal, since we're here.
Very well. And he doesn't ask you what drinks you'd like or anything like that. He just turns back to one of the kegs and pulls out 5 pints. Each one in sort of a big hefty mug. He puts them down on his home and goes, oh, don't worry about the price, you can pay when you leave.
Oh, you know I've always got you.
How are things anyway?
Oh, well, I'm currently on a job right now for, money to pay for last night. we're looking for a woman by the name of Togor. Has anyone come in with that name yet today?
Porga. Can't say so, really. Not really the ladylike kind of tavern a lot of the time, I guess.
Yeah.
No,
believe me, I know that.
Who are you looking for? What's she do? I might know something about her.
She's a trader. She, moves between all of the, towns.
Can't say I do. I mean, a lot of the people who come and stay here, they tend to be working, guarding the caravans or robbing them. Don't really tend to ask, to be honest. maybe somebody who knows her is here, but the actual traders themselves, they tend to be a bit too heavy purse for a place like this.
That's fair. All right. Well, thank you for the round, and I'll get you back later.
All right.
I'll lean forward and say, sorry, and I'll say this kind of quietly. What about Sefik Kaltro?
Make me a insight check, Fletch.
Oh.
Spooky.
11.
11. You're not 100% sure of the reaction, but I mean, there was something there. Almost as though Scramsax tensed up a little bit when you said that name. And with this, he kind of pulls up a stool and sits on his side of the bar and leans in and goes, now, what's a Goliath outsider like you doing saying a name like that? Because we have a bit of trouble with Sefik.
We're just looking to solve the trouble, that's all.
Are you now?
That is the job that we were speaking of earlier.
What do you know about this, Sefik?
Well, we know that he's got bright blue eyes, and he's never cold. And he's been up to some nonsense as of late, and
he's
don't know how much more
coin.
I want to say. Yeah, he's worth a little. He's got some interest in him.
You can see that there's a real kind of internal conflict. You don't need to roll to see it or anything. It's quite obvious. You can see Scramsax is almost like scared of saying something. And for now, he doesn't say anything.
Darmok's going to lean forward, just as if as Fletches, and say, Scrumsex, my friend. More coins means more coins for you. Tell me if you are, have anything.
Yes.
You know anything.
Darmok, I don't care about coins with this one.
Hmm.
He's holding us at knife point. Everything but physically. He only goes out at night. Never makes himself shown to patrons. After we close, he's here. Makes us serve him drinks and that. Me and the girls, we've been too scared to say anything. He's been here 3 days. We're just hoping he leaves afterwards.
So that's the perfect opportunity to catch the little bugger then, innit?
You don't want to catch him. He's not of this world, that one. Something wrong with him.
All right. My friend, why didn't you do something sooner? I would have handled this for you. I know that you're afraid, but...
I think he's the one who did that glassblower in, the dwarf.
If he is frightening these women, then he must be taken down. This is more than coin now.
Look, keep your voices down, all right?
Understood.
All right, well, listen. I've cleaned up worse. I'll put it that way, all right? So, if I were to tell you that he's sitting in one of the bedrooms upstairs, I reckon I could make the pub empty, you know, 10 or 20 minutes.
All right.
Go take a smoke break.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like a bad idea. With this, Scrumsax seems to sidle out from the bar and go and lean over at the table of old regulars. And without any seeming resistance, they all kind of just pick up their drinks and file out the front door. And you quickly see afterwards that they're just standing on the sort of like the outside patioed bit, essentially. Still just sipping their pints and standing with Scrumsax. And at this point, you hear a creaking floorboard above you. Would any of you like to do anything?
I'm going to take my drink and I'm going to chug it and
put it
down.
I don't know if I have my weapons on me.
You all have your equipment, fear not.
Okay.
It's all right, all I need is a stick. Here we go, boys.
I'm not that brutal a DM. Yeah. You have to fight with the broken stick.
Just 2 seconds. I need to run home quick.
Well, while Darmok's necking her pint, somebody begins to walk down the staircase. And you get a good look at him. And it would become immediately obvious that this appears to be Sefek Kaltro. Now, he fixes you with his bright blue eyes, and Sefek appears to be a well-built man, somewhere in his 30s. He has an olive complexion and dark hair pulled back into a ponytail. No beard, he's very well-trimmed and seems to look after himself. He's dressed in a very stylish outfit with matching pants and boots and seems to be very, well, Eddie, why don't you make me make me a history check with advantage, because it's very relevant.
Sure thing. I rolled a 21.
All right, you would immediately recognize that the boots that he's wearing are definitely sailor's boots.
Hmm.
These are very similar to mariners that you yourself would have traveled with. Typically, from more of a Baldur's Gate kind of area, like Southern Sword Coast is very, very of this fashion, if you like. However, this guy's most striking feature, as has been described to you many a time, is absolutely his eyes, almost shimmering with an icy blue. He wears no armor, no cold weather clothing, even inside the tavern with the fire lit. It's a feat that seems unbelievable. And he doesn't appear to be armed. And as he rounds the halfway point on the staircase and begins walking towards you all, you see a wry grin crack across his face and he goes, "My, my. I was wondering when somebody would turn up to give me a run for my money."
I like how we're fighting the Ice King from Game of Thrones. That's cool. All right, whatever.
And he just seems to be fixing you with a smile halfway down the stairs. And he goes, Do tell. Who do I have the pleasure of killing in her name today?
Darmok's gonna slam the drink down. Well, you will be facing me, but I will be doing the one doing the killing.
Ooh. Fatalistic words. And what about the rest of you? There's still time to run. You can always make it more enjoyable.
Oh no, we're all gonna kick your ass, laddie.
Are you now? Tell me, what led you here? I'm curious if I'm to die as you say. I'd know the hand that slay me.
Do you think that we'll let you know that?
I don't know. That's why I'm asking.
Maybe we're just a little pissed off that you're going around killing people, right? You think? Oh, maybe we're just a little bit mad about that?
Heinous accusation. You cut me to my very core.
Oh, so it's not you going around stabbing people, yeah?
Oh, no, it absolutely is.
All right, then we're going to kill you now.
I mean, having quite a jolly old time doing it, too. It's awfully nice to walk amongst such simple creatures and cut them down so simply.
At that, Darmok's going to take the sword out. This is fine this time, right?
Yeah, that one you can stab. Go get him.
Sefik fixes you with a confused glance and goes, well, I'm not exactly going to go calling for the guards now, am I? And with that, he seems to sort of like lash out with both of his arms to the sides, and immediately two daggers of pure ice appear in his hands.
I wondered how he made those.
And as he fixes you with a devilish grin on his face, that's where we'll take a break, and we'll return in time to fight Sefik Kaltru. Well, welcome back. We're getting into our first combat. The party is just about to face off against Sefik Kaltru, the weirdly, proudly self-admitted serial killer who's been stalking 10 towns. And we're just about to roll initiative, so if I could get you all to roll initiative, you do that by selecting your character and then clicking the initiative button, or you don't get a turn.
Ooh, 20.
I rolled an 11?
Soft. Still better than mine.
I rolled a 13 on Mr. Sefik. Okay, is everybody in? I think everybody's in.
Mm-hmm.
So, Fletch, why didn't you kick us off? First turn in combat.
All right. Well, the first thing I would like to do is draw my longbow, and I would like to move to this position here.
Uh-huh.
Can I shoot Sefik from this position?
Yes, I can. I would say so, yes.
All right, I will fire a shot with my longbow. A 19.
A 19 hits.
And it deals 8 piercing damage.
Oh, savage. All right, so your arrow thuds into Sethic. You can see it strike him just in sort of like the external muscle of his shoulder. And make me a perception roll, Craig. Why not?
Oh,
I'm scared.
An 11.
You don't quite see anything.
I don't quite see anything. Okay. And then with the rest of my movement, I am going to essentially just run up and stand alongside him.
Okay. All right. So, that's the end of your turn?
That's the end of my turn.
Suffolk's turn. My first turn. Let's go. TPK turn one. Let's speedrun this. let's have a look at distances. Lovely. All right. So, Suffolk is going to see you fire the arrow into him, and you're going to be running past him as he's just sort of glancing at this shaft protruding from his shoulder. And he just gives you a wry smile. And he is going to run full pelt towards you, Darmok. So, Butch, if you'd like to take an attack of opportunity, go ahead.
All right.
Slack him.
I got an 8.
Unfortunately, Sefik seems to move with a what could be called unnatural speed. And he is far too fast for your reactions, as you weren't prepared for him to charge away from you. And as he reaches you, Darmok, it looks like he's not going to stop. And he's just going to run full pelt into your face. However... at the last second, he disappears into a cloud of mist, and he appears right behind Eddie and Izar. And he is going to take swings at Izar with the dual daggers of frost. So that is... I just clicked the wrong button. Disregard that. All right, you guys can't even see any of this. Never mind. So his first swing is a 17 to hit.
Yeah.
All right, and you take... oh my... You take 7 points of piercing damage and 6 points of cold damage. Ooh. As the dagger slams into your back as he surprisingly appears behind you. How you doing after that, Isa? I just literally stabbed Justin off the Zoom call.
I think Justin is down.
Isa, are you down?
I have 10 max HP. I just took 16. No, sorry, math is hard. 13, yeah.
I will let you know, the rolls on the damage were ridiculous. Yeah. Okay, and well, with his second attack, after laughing to himself, he's going to swing the other dagger straight at you, Eddie, as you turn around.
Oh, God.
See this guy. Okay, that's a 7 to hit.
I made it! He missed!
Okay, he's too busy chuckling to himself after felling Izar and just wildly slashes above your head. And he goes, I told you you were in for more than you bargained for. And with that, he is going to end his turn. Eddie, you're up.
Great. Yeah, Eddie's a little spooked. as spooked as Eddie is right now, he's going to put his hands up and let's burn this place to the ground. I'm going to use burning hands.
All right.
Oof.
Does that just hit?
It's an area, right? Okay. It's a dex save, yes.
It's a dex save. Okay, so he rolls an 18.
That saves. So I believe it's half damage, so you take 5 whole wonderful damage.
Alrighty.
Nope, that's 4.
Four.
Math is hard.
Nice try, bro. Okay, so you do kind of like catch him with the edge of the blast of embers, and you can see it, you know, it does singe him a little bit, but far from a direct hit. Anything else?
Well, I don't really want to move, so I'm just going to stand here and hopefully not get stabbed.
All right, Isa, death saving throw, please.
13.
You make it. Mark a success.
Yep.
Dorosh Thea.
All right, I'm going to try and launch a guiding bolt at... Oh, can I? Because he's down, right? So can I just... Over.
You can blast him. You can see him between the two. Like,
okay. Otherwise, I'll just like move down here and then make sure I don't hit Mr. Blue Man.
You can absolutely blast through
the entire Blue Man group.
The entire Blue Man group. Yeah. All right. Whoop. Damn it.
Nope.
6.
Does not hit, I'm afraid.
Your huge
sort of shining bolt of energy just slams and dissipates against the wall behind him.
Damn it. Yeah, that's gonna be my turn then. Actually, I'm gonna move back behind the bar. Try to get some cover there. Okay, that's my turn.
Level 1 combat.
Yeah.
Level 1 combat.
That's great.
All right, is that the end of your turn?
Yeah.
Cool. Dalmok, you're up.
All right, I'm gonna shout out to Izar, my friend! And then I'm gonna run over. Oops, sorry. I'm gonna run over here. And say, Sefak, why don't you face me like a real man? And I'm going to swing at him with my longsword.
All right. 14 hits. Roll your damage.
Oh, you just click the longsword.
Oh, yeah, you
thing?
Just click where it says longsword and it'll roll your damage.
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
9
points. All right, you strike a very solid blow on him because as you swing, you realize that he's actually not defending himself. And you see the slash just cut across his chest and cut a ribbon across him. And make me a perception roll.
All right. Nine.
You rolled a 0, lol.
Yeah,
the other side.
Something's weird, but you can't quite tell what. And as the strike hits him, he kind of winces a little bit and goes, fight you like a real man, but I'm not a real man. It just grins in your face. Fletch,
I mean,
you're up.
Okay, I'm going to move to here and attempt to fire my longbow at him.
Mm-hmm.
23.
That certainly hurts.
7 piercing damage.
All right, and once again, the arrow thuds into him. Make a perception check with advantage because Darmok is standing right next to them, so they would contribute.
both 7.
You guys suck so much.
Yep. Not very perceptive.
Arrow hit him. Good job.
Yeah.
Right. I'm happy with that.
All right, now we are... Anything else?
I'm just going to use the last 10 points of movement and move there.
Okay. All right. Sefek's turn is now, and he is going to finish his little gloaty, cryptic sentence towards you, Darmok, and then he's going to smile once again and disappear in a cloud of mist.
Oh, hell.
And he's going to appear behind Dorothea.
Oh, great.
Ooh.
Where he will swing with his daggers of ice.
Stabby, stabby.
All right. The first one is a natural 20 on the attack.
Oh, yeah, that's gonna hit.
I'm killing you. Okay. Oh, okay, the rolls aren't so good. You take 8 points of piercing.
Yeah.
And 4 points of cold damage.
Oh, yeah, I'm down.
Okay. And then...
Jiminy Jillikers.
At this point, Sefek... He's going to actually grin at another one of your friends going down towards the standing group. And he's going to reach out, and the daggers of ice are just going to evaporate from his hands. And he's then going to hold out just one hand, and you're going to see a large, almost like a bastard sword of ice, appear and start resting on his shoulder as he grins towards you. And that'll be the end of his turn.
The economy of 2 attacks at level 1 is too much.
Eddie, you're up.
Continuing with the let's burn this place to the ground, gonna conjure up a firebolt, nice. Throw it at Sefek. Firebolt. God damn.
That's a miss.
Rolled a 7. God damn. All right. In which case, I will, I'll put myself here and try and hide behind the table there.
All right. He's a... Save. You make it. Hey,
hey!
All right, Dorothea, death save.
Yay, I'm
Lord,
so excited.
So many. Just 12.
You make it. Hey, Darmok, you're up.
Epic, I don't care what you are. Face me, and I'm gonna... Can I make it back over here?
Yep.
Okay. On the table, do it.
You're kind of shoving a table out the way, but I'll allow it.
Throw in the table.
You're a paladin. You can throw a table. You're fine.
Yeah, I can do that. Okay. 19.
That's only nice. Hits them.
All right.
Whack them.
4 slashing damage.
All right. You cut a thin line once again, crisscrossing his chest. Maybe a perception check.
This time, not so much.
You guys suck.
I'm just watching it.
Yep. All right. You're just.
I'm avenging my friends, okay? Let's,
yeah, you're focused on avenging.
Looking,
let's put it that way. All right.
There it is.
All right, Dorak, you're up. Or Mr. Right, Fudge.
I'm going to fire my longbow.
Do it.
25.
That certainly hits. Ooh, low-level archers are scary.
10 piercing damage.
Things
perfect. That's a good hit. All right, so you absolutely nail your arrow shot towards him, and it sticks in the flesh of his neck. But it doesn't seem to... He staggers back, and you can see he's weakened moving back forwards, but you can see that the arrow is just lodged in his neck. And, okay, both you and Darlok make perception checks with advantage, because you're right
good
next
luck.
To him.
Good luck. Good luck.
Oh my god, you guys suck.
Dear Lord, people.
Dear 11 Lord. And 8.
All right.
Kat, 10 and a 4.
You know what, Kat? It's so obvious, I'll say that you see, okay?
At this point.
With 11, I'll say you
11.
Both see, okay?
Okay.
The arrow hit his neck. Like, that would normally be a pretty visceral, disgusting wound. Mm-hmm. This guy doesn't bleed.
He doesn't bleed.
Okay.
Okay, I will use my movement to go over here, and end my turn.
Alrighty, Sefek Kaltra's turn. So at this point, once again, he turns towards you, Darmok, and he's like, "Once again, he turns towards you, Darmok, and he's like, if you insist on a dance, I guess I'll have to allow it." And he's going to swing down the sword towards you. This large longsword that he's now conjured from ice. And the first attack is an 8. So it just clangs off your raised shield. And you can see the ice actually like shatter from the blade. But as he's raising it back up, it just reforms in his hand. And he swings again. And the next one is a natural one. So again, this time you sort of preempt the attack and you just bash out with your shield and it just shatters the sword everywhere. So that's going to be the end of his turn.
How's that for a dance?
Tanking is good. Let's go.
I'm gonna run over here.
Nice.
Less scared. Throw another firebolt at him.
A firebolt goes at him. God. That's a 10. That does not hit, I'm afraid.
I mean, it's not an action, so I'm just gonna stand over this dead body of a guy I still don't know the name to. I do know the name. That's a lie. And just be very scared that he's dying.
All right.
And that's it.
Eddie is spooked to end the turn. He's our death saving throw.
Ooh.
Mark a failure. That's a 4. Dorothea, death saving throw.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
That's a 5. Mark a failure.
Yep.
Dalmok, you're back.
All right. Yes. Keep dancing with me, and then I'm going to use my last lay on hands to up Dorothea.
Okay. How much healing is that?
Just 1. I only have 1 more.
One
so Dorothea,
hit point?
You are,
one hit
you're
point.
Back. You are
one
prone,
hit point.
But you have 1 hit point.
Yay!
Yes,
that means
just focus
spend
on
half
me.
Your
ignore
movement
everyone
next
else.
Turn to stand up.
Okay.
Try hit me again.
Do I clear my death saves?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Anything else?
That's it. I'm just gonna stand there.
Fletch, you're up.
Okay, I shall stow the bow and whip out my great sword and swing it at him. For a 9. Nice.
That's a miss, I'm afraid. He just kind of casually sidesteps.
I do look silly. I'm just gonna end my turn.
All right.
Just gonna look silly and end my turn.
Sefek's turn. So he's gonna see all of your very, very obvious baiting, Darmok. And he's going to sort of like shoot you a wry smile because he knows what you're doing. And he's going to go, oh, come on now. That's just cheating. And he is going to immediately flash of blue light, 2 ice daggers back in his hand. He's going to just lash out with the right one down at the ground towards Dorothea. And that is that's going to have advantage, by the way, because you're prone. That is actually not great. That's an 11 to hit.
No hitty.
Wow.
You are terrible at aiming.
He's so casual about it that it just scrapes across your armor. And he kind of goes, fine. And he's going to punch out with the last one towards you, Darmok, which is a 13 to hit. It's just going to shatter. It seems like his ice weaponry is having a horrendous time getting through your armor.
Here.
All right. And that's going to be the end of his turn. Eddie, you're up.
Firebolt, firebolt. This will be the time.
Not 20, whack. Let's go.
Oh, 23.
23.
Nice.
That's a natural 19.
John, I'm very pleased to say this. You can roll your damage because you.
Bop! 5 fire damage.
5 bops.
Mid rolls.
All right, you can see the fireball impact him on his chest and kind of singe some of the cuts he already had, but you really, really see it recoil when you hit it with the fire. And while it doesn't seem to be causing extra damage, you can see that this thing hates the fire. Definitely.
I mean, this is not the first time I've shot him with fire, but yeah.
Right. Izar Sol.
Damn.
Another fail.
Ruh-roh.
6, I'm at 2-2, baby!
First party death, let's go!
I don't have any more land.
Just freaking... Oh, wait.
All right,
this
everybody
isn't
shut up.
3.
Everybody shut up, because it's the cleric's turn.
It's the cleric's turn.
It's the cleric who doesn't want to move away from this guy.
Now, as a DM, I don't like telling you what to do, but...
Roll away.
I know. I want to kill him, though, but I should
and
probably go away.
She's a dwarf, so she has low movement speed.
Wait, I have to get up still.
Yeah, so you spend half your movement getting up because you're prone.
I'll tell you that you have exactly enough movement to get there.
Yeah. All right, so I'm going to disengage. Is that my action?
Don't you have healing word?
Don't I have healing word? I do. Oh, right.
So that's ranged. Yeah.
Yeah, it's ranged.
Oh, it's ranged. Right. Yep. Sorry, I thought I had to be by him. So I'm just going to be like...
That's paladins.
I don't like you, but get up, you lazy sod.
Now you can roll your healing word healing.
Boop.
as Dorothea's vaguely insulting words reach your slipping out of consciousness ears.
I will roll it. Boop.
You get back with four health.
Four health. Yay,
don't
it's more than what I have.
Don't put my coffin yet, I'm alive.
Now, Ailey, because you're new to clerics, sorry if you already know this, I believe Healing Word is your bonus action. Bonus. So I think you can also take an attack.
You can do something.
Oh, sweet. Yes, that's cool. Thank you. So then I would like to... You have cleric before. I would like to try this spell, Inflict Wounds.
Nice.
That's a very good spell.
That seems like
touch
fun.
Touch him in his feet. Touch him in his feet.
I'm going to do that. I'm going to just grab onto him and be like, fuck you. No, not like that. Where is it? Inflict Wounds. Boop.
Damn
it! Oh. That one.
It's a natural one. So you do see his eyes light up in some surprise as your hand starts glowing. Unlike your usual sort of healing energy, your hand starts glowing with almost like this pallid, sickly green color. And you reach out to just try and grab him by the chest, but he sees it coming and he gets out of the way. But you do see an element of surprise in his eyes.
Okay.
All right. Is that the rest? Is that the end of your turn?
I'm not moving. He'll kill
Good
me.
Good idea. Good idea. All right. Delmark, you're up.
Wonderful. It is 5v1 again. Let's try this again. Eight is not eight.
Brady sidesteps out the way with another shit-eating grin on his face. Anything else?
That's it.
All right. Fletch, you're up.
Great sword. 23.
That certainly hits. You can roll your damage.
Eight slashing damage.
Once again, you slice deep into the tissue of one of his arms and... His body is definitely beginning to weaken. Even if he doesn't seem to visibly be bothered by the damage, it is definitely starting to weaken under him. Anything else?
That's me.
All right. So Sevak is going to glance down at these wounds that he's sustaining and kind of snort to himself and just go, all right, well, that's more than enough fair play, I think. And he's going to Misty Step. And he's going to go...
I told you.
Right in front
of course
Eddie and Izzar. And first off, he's going to take a stab out with his ice daggers towards you, Eddie. That is an 11 to hit.
That exactly
hits. That's your AC. Oh my god, yeah.
Oh
okay.
Dear.
Here we go, boys. Mage armor, if only I took mage armor.
Take seven mage piercing armor. Damage.
Uh-huh.
Plus.
Uh-huh.
Three.
Nighty-night.
Nighty-night. Yeah. He falls on the ground.
With his, watching Eddie fall at his feet, he's just going to scoff to himself and turn towards you, Izzar, where the other dagger will swing. And that is a 21 to hit. For...
Good night.
Good night.
I'll just tell you it's 12 points of damage in total.
He had four health, you know.
All right. So he quickly fells your two spellcasting companions, and he turns back towards the more martial section of the party with a grin on his face, and he simply goes, don't you just find mages the absolute worst?
What a bitch.
And he's gonna stand to do anything yet. Facing towards you, Fletch.
I suppose you haven't, that's right.
Oh, yeah.
You haven't, actually.
Don't worry, later levels, your time will come. All right.
Yeah, I was gonna commence, punk ass.
Eddie, death saving throw.
No, sir.
Mark of failure.
Gross.
Izzar, death saving throw.
Oh.
I got a nat one. Two failures for me.
Oh, that's two.
That's a natural one.
Ruh-roh.
It had to come. There was too many death saves.
All right. Dorothea, your turn.
I want to move past. I'm going to try kill him. I'm going to move past here just so I don't zap them in the schnoz. I can cast Healing Word again, right?
Did you use all your spell slots? How many do you have?
I've used two.
How many do you have?
Two.
So you used all your spell slots. You don't have healing anymore.
I don't have healing anymore. I've got Spare the Dying. Does that work?
Yeah. That's the can't. That's not a.
Is that no
bonus action? I don't think.
Am I allowed to use that? I suppose I didn't check.
Spare the Dying. Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Just insta-stay.
One action touch. You touch a living creature that has zero hit points, they become stable. The spell has no effect on undead or constructs. Alright, I'd really like to kill this biatch, but I'm gonna go over to my fallen companion and use Spare the Dying on them. Does that stabilize them?
many things.
Yes. So they no longer have to roll death saving throws, but they are not conscious.
Yeah, but they're not.
Okay,
they are,
but you're
medically fine, but they are unconscious for the next foreseeable future.
You're fine for now. I'm gonna say to him, you live through this, you owe me, laddie.
I don't hear you. I'm not conscious.
I know. I'm just saying it to you because you'll know it in your brains, okay? Anyway.
Anything else?
That's my turn.
Okay, Darmok, your turn.
All right. I'm going to run over to him again, say, stop downing my friends and attack me. And I'm going to hit him with nice. 17.
Okay, that certainly hits. Roll your damage.
Nice.
Okay, you land a solid blow once again, just hacking away chunks of this guy, but he doesn't seem to be stopping yet. Anything else?
That's all my turn. I'm just going to try to antagonize him more.
All right. Fletch, you're up.
All right, I'm going to pull out my longbow again, and I'm going to try and fire an arrow right into his big, stupid head.
23!
Has nobody nat 20'd except me yet?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Yay, I'm the best. All right.
Bloody hell, 3 damage.
So you kind of fire a very accurate shot, but it seems to hit almost like a fold of clothing and not really deal too much damage.
All right.
But hit nonetheless.
I'll just close the distance and go over here.
All right. So, Sefek's turn. And he turns towards you, Darmok, and just goes, you're the only person who's ever asked me to attack them. How strange. Anyway, he's going to turn towards you, Fletch, and swing with his two daggers.
Bring it on, I'm ready.
The first one is a... When it rolls, it's a 15 to hit.
It misses.
Okay, that misses you. Duck, dip, dive, and dodge out of the way of the first dagger. And then the second one, that's a 24.
24 hits, yes.
I imagine that hits, yeah. And you take 6 points of piercing plus 7 points of cold damage.
All right, well, I'm going to use Storm's Endurance. So when I take damage, I can use my reaction to roll a d12 and add my constitution modifier to it. And I negate that much damage. I'll just roll 1d12.
Nice.
And it's plus 3. So I subtract 6 from your total. What was your total?
Okay, so you take 7 points of cold damage.
7 damage, okay.
Cool. All right, so yeah, you seem to, you all see, except Izar, who's like basically dead, you all see, like, it appears as though Fletch can shrug off significant damage. He just kind of tanks his way through a dagger blow. All right, that's going to be the end of Sefek's turn. Now, Eddie, you know what time it is. That's a fail.
Lovely.
Oh.
Please, no.
That's two failures, right?
You're basically out of combat at this point. You can't really take any actions. So, Dorothea.
I'm going to try again. I'm going to move myself over here. And I'm going to try inflict wounds once more.
Do you have the spell slot to cast that?
No, I don't. Damn it. I'm learning. Spells
have
are...
two death saves on someone.
Spells are fun.
Also, you can actually only use a cantrip with another spell in one turn. That was a mistake earlier, but it doesn't matter. Like,
okay.
I thought so. I wasn't sure. Comments.
All right.
All right. Hey, first time playing a cleric.
Yeah.
All right, fine. Screw it. I'm going to whip out the mace then and try and bludgeon him.
All right, big bludgeony boy.
Frick!
Let's go.
How have I rolled 2 nat
That's
ones
a
in a row?
One.
Holy
That's a natural
shit.
One. That's a natural one. And that was a turn that was spent not sparing the dying. All right, so, Darmok, your turn.
I know. I want you to hit me because you suck at it. And I'm going to hit him again. For a natural one.
Oh.
2 natural ones in a row.
Bruh.
Gad.
Real bruh moment. Bruh. All right, anything else? Bonus action to feel ashamed. Yep, all right.
yep.
Fletch, you're up.
Okay, the first thing I'm going to do is use Second Wind. So it's 1d10 plus my fire level, and I regain that much health.
Alright.
So it's. Whoops, that's the right command. Alright, so, well, I gained 10 points total, like, I rolled a 9.
Craig, I do think you can click Second Wind on your character sheet and it'll do it for you.
Oh, you're probably right. I just did it the difficult way.
Alright, you gain a 9 plus your con, right?
It's my fighter level, so just a humble one. But then I'm going to swing my greatsword for a 16.
16 hits.
8.
All right, does that nice, kill? Nice solid blow. He is staggering on his feet, but he is not dead.
Shit.
Oh. All right, so we go to the turn of Sefek Kaltro, who is now a little bit worse for wear, and his grin seems to be getting a bit more maniacal and seems to be becoming a bit more loose with his actions, and he is going to lash out towards you, Darmok, and he just goes, fine, if it's death you want, I suppose I'll have to give it to you. He's going to swing out with his daggers. The first one is a natural one, that certainly doesn't hit. The second one is a 10, which isn't going to hit
it's
either.
Not hit either.
Oof. All right, so yeah, he just clangs, like, you can see he's acting quite, like, recklessly at this point, essentially. And he just hammers, breaking daggers down to their hilts into your armor, but then immediately regens the daggers, but no effect on you whatsoever.
Come on.
John.
Oh, I'm so scared. I'm really afraid.
If I die, I blame Alias.
Yeah, I figured.
John dies, the exact same character is coming back as Teddy next episode.
I was gonna say Wetty, but yeah, okay.
Wetty's
all right, John.
Wetty.
Ha!
I'm so relieved. You have no idea.
You have
so
no
much
idea.
Planning would have just exploded if you died.
Oh, I did so much planning.
Oh, I'm so glad. John rolled a 16 and made his death save. I'm not sure if he actually got to saying that.
Sorry, yes. 16.
All right, yes. You're having a nap. Dorothea.
Oh, I'm going to go spare the dying now.
Thank you.
You gotta go around. You're taking an attack of opportunity.
I gotta try. Yeah, I'm gonna try to go around, take an attack of opportunity. So.
Alright. He takes a swing with one of his regenerated daggers. That is a 15 to hit.
It just hits. Crap.
And that is, you're down, I'm afraid.
Yeah,
I'm down.
Fuck!
12 points of piercing damage. His dagger rolls, the damage rolls are so high. He's had like one low roll, I think. Yeah, you're down, I'm afraid, as you try to run away.
I'm trying.
Darmok.
All right. I thought you said you were going to hit me, and he's going to hit me.
Wow.
21.
Jeez, you guys are rolling really well. Please kill him.
9 points of slashing damage.
Please kill him.
So you take a slash, you like cut the inside of his leg, basically, and it nearly drops him to his knees. This guy is hanging on by a thread.
Okay.
Oh my.
Fletch.
The Fletch. I shall swing my great sword once more.
Please hit him.
13.
Hit him.
13. 13 hits.
Oh my goodness, really?
Roll your damage.
Six damage.
Get him down.
I guess he has 7 health left.
Connor, don't fucking tease me!
Actually, come on.
You jam your sword all the way through him and pull it out, and he briefly falls to his knees before staggering up, breath rasping. You can see a faint blue light leaving his mouth and almost like bleeding out of his eyes, but he is still standing for the moment. And he is going to flail once again at you, Darmok.
Okay.
He has this, like, almost, like, twisted smile on his face.
Ooh, I don't like that.
And he swings for a 7 and then a 24. So 24 hits?
24 hits.
All right. The damage is 5 plus. That's 10 points of damage.
Okay.
All right.
Does Darmok resist cold damage at all?
I do have resistance.
Oh, okay. So 5 of that is half. So you take 7 points of damage.
Okay.
Yeah. As you feel this sharp pain, find just a gap in your armor, essentially, and punch through for a light cut. However, that is going to be the end of Sefek's turn. And we're going to move on to John.
Come on, John.
I don't want to look. 15.
Yeah. I've just stopped caring. I've become so morbid about this.
I don't care anymore.
This is like episode 50, not one. This
is
holy shit.
If I die, I'm gonna spoil the whole goddamn campaign.
It was Santa Claus all along, Austin.
I'm sorry, John. I'm sorry.
Dorothea, you're dead.
Yeah, I am dead.
Yeah.
A saving throw.
Save.
Darmok, please.
Can I
put
use
this.
That one?
No, I'm gonna try. Just die.
Go, Tex. Go, Tex.
Oh, 8.
You miss. You just miss. You just clang into the wall. Fletch.
Craig, come on, I Fletch. Swear to God.
Right. Come on, Craig.
Craig, I'm sorry.
All right, I'm going to
step back in longbow.
Yes, I'm going to attempt to step back.
All right. Okay, you take an attack of opportunity. He hasn't used that this round. No, he hasn't. Okay, so Ice Dagger is an 8. You don't get
misses.
Hit.
All right, here we go. Firing the longbow.
Ooh.
12.
It's 12. I don't think it's 12.
12 is his AC. It hits.
Yes! 9!
Please,
so
9.
So, how
good.
Does your final arrow fail?
Yes.
Right through his fucking eye!
Right through his eyes. So, this arrow is just vengeance unleashed. It just slams through his eyes so hard that it comes out the back of his head and actually pins him to the wooden wall behind him.
Oh my god, that's disgusting.
I wish Eddie was alive to see that.
Just nailed to the wall. The grin doesn't fade from his face. I mean, you can see this almost like blue magical essence essentially leaking from his eyes and mouth and nose. And he just glances a side eye towards you, Darmok, and goes, oh well, it was fun while it lasted. And then the blue seems to almost like, for a moment even, just gush out of him, and then the body just slumps dead.
Yes.
What the hell was that?
Darmok's gonna put his longsword back and gonna just look over to our Goliath friend, pat him on the back and be like, it's over.
I got the ball good shot in a bit, yeah? Not a bad fight.
Darmok's gonna look at everyone else that's like kind of dead on the floor and it's over.
I think we'd better go and try and administer some aid, I guess.
Yeah,
so.
I'm gonna open the door.
I assume that you pick everybody up.
Yeah.
Stabilize them, do what we can.
Well, when you're trying to stabilize them, you actually notice that Scramsax comes back in. He goes, oh, I heard the fight was over. I've got something for this. And he very briskly walks and opens the what are they called? The sort of bar doors that swing up so you can walk through the bar. Is there a name for those?
The one that hits you on the head.
I know what you're saying. I know the one you mean, but I don't know.
Opens the bar counter, we'll say, and walks through, and he kind of rummages in the glasses below and pulls out an old dusty box that you can very clearly see has a rack of dusty healing potions in there. He's like, these ain't much. I think they're leftovers from my older days, but use these. Give them to the ones that are injured. They'll be all right. And there's 4 potions in there, so have at it.
Thank you so much, Scramsax. And we're gonna...
I imagine we dispense them amongst the 3 dead people.
Okay, so yeah, we'll say they have 1 healing potion left, and he's like, oh, you can keep that. I really hope I don't have need for it these days.
Is it, are we still playing the D&D where you get 4 heals?
Potions? No.
Or are we rolling?
Okay. We're rolling.
Roll that 1D, whatever it is.
What 8. Is it?
8.
1D4 plus 4?
1D4 plus 4 for a base level 1, yeah.
Yeah, that's what
I know. Are you rolling, Connor, or shall we?
Oh, you can roll.
I got a 2.
I got a 3. I have almost full health. There you go, boy.
Yeah, look at me go.
A 1.
I rolled a 1.
Where are the llamas?
Eddie pukes a little. When he wakes up.
What happened? Did we win?
Yes, my friend. He is slain.
I look down at my clothes and I see several tears. What the hell happened to my regalia?
Regalia.
Do you have any idea how much this costs?
At this point, you see the group of old regulars walk back in the door beside you, and they all kind of stare and look for about 1 or 2 seconds, and then slowly walk off and sit back at their table and resume the pint sipping.
They just don't care about the corpse.
Can I walk towards Sevig's body and just, not even with a knife, just with my finger reach into his eye and pop the eye out?
Yeah.
Nice.
Sure. So
I thought that was the token we were gonna get.
That's Derek levels of...
You gouge this guy's eye out, and his body is ice cold to the touch. Like, this guy... Something not right.
I want to look at him. I want to, see if he's got any other stuff in his pockets and stuff.
All right, make me an investigation check.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to order a drink at the bar.
Oh, for Pete's sake, my rolls have been ass today. 3. I find nothing.
Yeah, there's nothing really of interest in his belongings, to be perfectly honest.
Okay.
John, yeah, you're just given a drink as you walk up, even by Scram Sacks. He doesn't even wait for you to order one.
I'm drowning in alcohol.
I want one too. I'm gonna go to the bar and have a beverage.
Yeah, he pulls out a drink for each and he just goes, yeah, all of you, grab a table, get some rest. Don't worry about him. He gestures towards Sefek. He goes, me and the old boys will have him gone by the time we're open for the evening.
Thank you, Scram Sacks, for letting us use this. Hopefully you and the ladies can be safe tonight again.
Yeah, the girls will be alright.
Being sad.
Well, nobody died, so job well done. Cheers. I'll cheers whoever
can't
will
you,
cheers.
Can't you fix your plunge? The same way you cleaned the rugs?
No, I can make them clean, but...
I elbow Fletch and say, he's not that good.
Oh, right, okay. He did spend most of that fight on his ass, so...
He spent that entire fight on his ass.
All right, like so would any of you like to do anything in the bar? Are you taking a short rest, we'll say, and...
A short rest and a drink.
I short rest and my drink.
Hey, short rest, I get to regain my spell points. Oh, wait.
Oof.
I spent the battle on my ass. Izar will remember this.
Yes.
And what are you getting back for a short rest?
You can
roll
hit
your
dice.
Hit die, and some classes gain some stuff.
I'm going to use Arcane Recovery to get my one spell slot back.
Hey.
Ooh, woo.
I'm back at full health. Woo.
And I'm
a whole 10.
I'm actually going to save hit die because I'm only missing 2 health, and if I get hit, I'm dead anyway. So there you go.
Yeah, John, your health is binary. It's either there or it's 0.
So, do we wait to go talk to Lynn tomorrow, or?
Well, she said she'd be in the market at noon, right?
Pretty late, I assume. I look out the window.
Yeah, I mean, realistically, you were in quite a prolonged fight with Sefek. It's starting to get truly dark at this point, so about 4:30 or 5. Certainly too late for the markets.
Hmm. I think it wouldn't wait till tomorrow. We can have a celebration drink tonight and handle, get some coin tomorrow.
Well, just don't lose the eye, that's all. But I suppose we got a corpse here. We can
pop the eye into one of these empty bottles.
Could do that.
Darmok, thinking of that, Darmok's gonna go and with his dagger, cut the other eye out just in case.
Didn't that one get exploded by an arrow?
I thought it was through
the brain.
The
forehead, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's nice. Another eye for the taking.
I would like to take the other eye. Just
you cut the other eye out.
Can I actually take a look at the eye? Is it still glowing blue, or is it?
No, it's no longer glowing, but it is almost like it's had like a bright blue dye diffused through it. It's got this effervescent, just bright icy blue color in it. It's unlike any human or humanoid eye you've seen before.
Well, I would just hold it out to everyone at the table and just say, have you seen anything like this before? That's like no man I've ever seen.
Why isn't it glowing blue anymore?
You should know, Mr. Magic Man, who's critiquing other magic people. It's obviously magic something. As you can tell, I'm freckled from being... sleeping the entire time.
Too long of a nap. I roll an arcana check? I don't know.
Yeah, go ahead, roll an arcana check.
Flack.
Quite hard.
Wow, though. Okay. Wow.
Natural
one.
I will just say this is unlike any magic you're familiar with.
I figured.
I would imagine it's not glowing because it's not part of his skull any longer.
If that's the case, is any other part of him glowing?
I don't know.
Feel free to go look.
I'm going to look.
Nope.
Does this just look like a random corpse now?
It looks like corpse that is still ice cold to the touch.
He's cold. Too cold.
He's a smart man.
Well, he wasn't bleeding during that fight when we attacked him. Each hit drew no blood.
Perhaps he was a corpse.
Perhaps.
I don't know.
Could be something
maybe,
like that.
Maybe
we're
talking no
for a dead man if he was.
Well, a little wondering. Too much for our liking, I think.
Aye.
Well, if anyone has any repairs that need made to their armor, I will happily offer my services. And then we can go cash in our coin tomorrow. Do you all have lodgings for the night?
I was going to take his room.
At that comment, Scramsex does look over and go, "You're all welcome to stay here, obviously. Just know it gets a little bit rowdy at night."
Scramsex, you have the usual room for me, right?
Yeah. Not many people stay in these days on account of the bleak, endless, horrible winter.
I typically would go back to my more luxurious lodgings, however.
You're not going anywhere, what? Laddie.
Yeah, no, I trailed off.
You stay here, we'll make sure you're taken care of.
That's what happens when you get knocked down, get back up again, get knocked down again.
Never gonna keep me down.
Mm-hmm.
They were close. Real close.
Can't believe I got to two failures immediately.
Yeah, that was pretty scary.
Yeah, he got a natural one, though.
I was scared.
That's true.
That's worse.
That was a lot of very
sorry for not
people.
Healing you. I was like, I can maybe kill the guy.
It went fine.
No one died.
It's fine.
No one's dead yet.
So, yeah, all right, so I guess we're lodged for the night.
Yeah.
All right, so would any of you like to do anything in particular, or are you happy to kind of rest and relax the evening away?
I think we're going to drink the evening away.
There is something I'd like to ask the party, though. I would just turn to everyone at some point and just say, so, how long's everyone been in Bryn Shander for? A
couple of years, I think, give or take. How about yourself?
I've been here about a year or so.
I think I've seen you around in the market a little bit.
I'm not the most subtle, I'm afraid.
Yeah, I can't exactly miss you. Unlike me, I can scoot around, nobody finds me.
I love that. I've been here a couple months.
You're new here.
Yeah, my mom told me to come up here for some reason.
Your mom?
What? Yeah, my mom.
Yes, My grandmother sent me up here. How long have you been here, Izor?
What? What?
How long have you been here?
Yeah.
You may have not died twice. Addle-brained at the moment.
Yeah, a month or something like that. Yep. Mm-hmm.
It's been a few months for me as well. Still getting a bearings and found this tavern quite at home for my usual spots.
Seems like you're pretty friendly with old Scramsax over here. Not somewhere I usually go.
And a few of the ladies have already met me.
Wink!
Alright, so you guys just kind of drink and chat between yourselves for the rest of the evening until eventually it's time to retire to your lodging. Scramsax has put you all up and kind of not shoes you up, but suggest that you go up a little bit earlier than the true rowdiness can begin, and generally speaking, you seem to get a relatively peaceful night's sleep given the circumstances. So when you wake in the morning, it's another bright-ish day in for Enchanter. Is there anything you'd like to do?
Nope. Just get up, go find some breakfast maybe, if there's any downstairs.
Yeah.
Liquid breakfast.
Alright, so as you go down, you do see that there is no real food offering here, to be honest. There's not really any
bar peanuts
for it. Really, no, there doesn't seem to be anything peanuts. Edible. Lots of drinkable things, but nothing particularly edible in the North Look, as far as you can tell. So you might have to head to the market or find food elsewhere.
Well, we can head to the market and wait for
Clint.
Clint
or Clint?
Helin. It's Flynn. H-L-I-N.
Oh. Flynn. Okay.
I never got that.
I spelled it wrong. Thought it
yeah,
was
it's
just
a super,
Flynn.
Super weird name. Flynn.
I thought it was Clynn, but Clynn
yeah.
makes more sense.
All of those make more sense. Yeah.
Yeah.
But no, it is H-L-I-N. Okay. Anyway, as you guys head out of the tavern and back to the markets to find Hlin and claim your reward, well, that's where we'll end the first session, so well done.
That was the most death-defying episode we've ever had.
That was so scary.
Yeah, I was scared. Insane.
Two people on death save, like two death saving throws is crazy, like.
Not a fan.
First.
Yeah, anyway, thank you guys so much for watching. It's been an absolute pleasure. We hope you enjoyed the first episode. We'll be back in 2 weeks' time for episode number two. Can't wait. Leave a like if you enjoyed the video, of course, and a comment letting us know. And anyway, we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Beautiful.